भक्ति योगा द पाथ ऑफ इमोशंस हाउ टू प्यूरिफाई अवर इमोशंस हाउ टू मूव फ्रॉम ग्रास टू सटल इमोशंस एंड व्हाट इज द वेरी सोर्स फ्रॉम वेयर द इमोशंस अराइज वन ऑफ द फोर मेन स्ट्रीम्स ऑफ योगा ज्ञान योगा राज योगा भक्ति योगा karma yoga. The goal of all yogas is to reach the same goal. That goal is called moksha. Patanjali called it as probably kaivalya. Buddha probably called it as nirvana. In Bhagavad Gita it is called brahma nirvana. Different names have been given. In scientific terminology, we can say that reality, the search for reality is the goal of all scientific investigations. The science which started 400 years back in modern terms in the West, Newton and Descartes kept the goal as search for reality. Is it possible to find out the reality? Let us do that. Investigations. But soon they found that this world is very, very complicated, very sophisticated. We cannot understand even the simple physical world as to how the rain falls, how the lightning occurs. Therefore, they said in the beginning that let us start with simple grass dimensions of this universe, and once we go and complete this understanding about the physical world, then we'll go to the subtle world. 400 years it took for us. Now we are going further, beyond the physical, to understand whether there is something prana. What is it that we call as emotions? What is the relation between mind and emotions? Is there something like pure consciousness? From where this whole creation has come, into this region of subtlety, modern science has started moving. Our ancient seers in our country, great Maharishis, saints, yoga masters, fathom the whole creation. What science has done over 400 years, our people had done it long, long, long ago. And at that time, they develop a philosophy, just like modern science, that everything is nothing but matter. You know. The body is the only thing that is important. What is the goal of life? To enjoy life. You know. Sense pleasures. For that you need money. So try to earn the money in the right royal way. But if you cannot do that, doesn't matter. By hook or crook. Take loans from everywhere and enjoy life. But you should be very, very intelligent, shrewd, not to get caught, not to go behind the bars. Once you die, what is going to happen? Everything is finished. So who is going to come and ask you to return the loan? Runam krutva grutam pive. That is the philosophy we have. Almost in the same philosophy today. What is the goal of life? I want to become a millionaire. I want to become a billionaire. Money is the supreme end. The goal of life it has become today. Why? Because from that I can have the comforts, I can have the enjoyment, I can have the sense pleasures has come to pass. And the modern things is based on this materialistic philosophy, matter-based paradigm. But in our country, thousands of years back, they went far beyond that. After the Charvaka philosophy, they found that no, there is something beyond the physical. And they started understanding more and more. And emotions, the most important, has to be understood. The mind has to be fathomed. What is the relation between mind and emotions? Had to be unraveled. All that they did. And all that is available to us in our Bhagavad Gita. So Bhagavad Gita is the Bible in India, we can say. Here, all streams of yoga have been put forth. Every chapter is a yoga. 18 chapters, 18 yogas. So Vivekananda said, we can codify all this into four main streams. Jnana Yoga, Raja Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga. What is the goal? Moksha. What is that nature? Freedom. Absolute freedom. Freedom from all tensions and stresses. Freedom from all miseries. Freedom from all diseases. Freedom from all bondages. Because that is the most infinite goal. Almost utopic. Unbelievable. Our seers were not happy if they became a millionaire or a billionaire or had the whole world under their control. They said, no, we are not satisfied. We want infinite happiness, infinite power, infinite knowledge, infinite bliss we want. They said, that is moksha. We consider, therefore, our seers were most ambitious people. How to do that? They evolved the method for that. The Bhakti Yoga is to use emotions and thereby grow to the moksha sthiti. How to do that? Has been given in the 18 verses that we chanted. Unfortunately, there is no component in modern education. And therefore, we have to augment it. We have to supply this knowledge base, incorporate into our education system. Otherwise, what is going to happen? Even in our country, it will become like Australia. Teenagers, 40% of the teenagers are all becoming depressed. Depression has become the biggest challenge in Australia. So we have to see that the emotions and emotion culture, gaining mastery over the emotions, should be brought forth there. That is what Bhakti Yoga tells us. The 18 verses, the whole spectrum has been given. The other day when we started, how do we begin Bhakti Yoga? We must understand that we have Asuri Sampat and Daivi Sampat. The good and the bad. It's what all management systems always emphasize. You must first do the SWOT analysis. Strength and weakness analysis. Any system, what is its strength? What is the weakness? Similarly, this system, the human system, what is the strength? What is the weakness? What is the Daivi Sampat? What is the Asuri Sampat? Has to be analyzed. So he does, what are those Daivi and Asuri Sampat? He says that let's take to this verse. Who are the people who come to this path to move towards the moksha? Four types of people, he says. Chaturvidha bhajante maam.
Chaturvidha bhajante maam.
Janas sukruti
norjuna. Janas sukruti norjuna.
Artho jignasurathārthi.
Artho
Shabham. Four types of people. Artha, Jignasu, Arthardi, Jnani. Four types of people come into this path. Who is Artha? A person who is in distress, who has lot of misery, and he diagnosed as cancer, or he loses big money. All the investment in share has collapsed. Or suddenly he feels that he is completely wrecked. All types of miseries that we get. He is an artha. Then what happens? That person thinks of God. In Kannada the proverb is there, Sankata Bandhaga Venkatramana. So we think of God when we are in great misery. So people will start coming towards it. Then they start going to temple, they start coming into this area. Who is the second? Jignasu. Jignasu is a person who is curiosity oriented. How is it that today so many people have started coming to yoga field? art of living, you know, thousands of people go for Shivaratri, it's also go and then see. For Ramdev's yoga classes, there are thousands and thousands of people who go. Let me also go there and see. Otherwise they will never go there. Curiosity, just like the children. No, they go there. That is it. Jignasu. Artharthi is a businessman. For me, everything, nothing but business. Nowadays, even the IT companies have started coming down. No? Therefore, can I see that I can use this yoga as a franchise and see that I make lots of money? How to use yoga to market itself and get the money? Is that artha arthi? He is a businessman. Always his direction is artha, artha, artha. Artha is money. And the fourth type is the jnani. Jnani is the person, you know, who is a search for reality, a scientist. And these four types of people come into this line, he says. And look at the magnanimity of Krishna. He says that te sarve sukrutinaha. Chaturvidha bhajante ma te sukrutinaha. He Arjuna, they are all good people. Don't belittle them. Just because he has gone for a business, don't belittle them. Let them come. As a franchise also, let them come into the yoga field. Just because he has got difficulty, problems and miseries and disease, he comes to yoga. Okay, he is also welcome. And he is a jignasu, just for a curiosity he might come. A long pyramid. All these people come there. And out of thousands and thousands and thousands of people have come there, millions of people coming. 20 billion people doing yoga in the United States today. 20 billion people doing yoga. All people are coming, big pyramid. Out of that, Varshanam Sahasreshu, Kaschid Yatada Siddhaya, they will start really getting into the yoga. They start practicing regularly. Otherwise they have gone for a short while and then gone for one day practice or one day in a week practice and then forget about it. But those who start doing it regularly, maybe one in a thousand. Among thousands of such people who practice, then there will be one person who really understands what is yoga and start going in the right direction towards moksha. All these things happen. That's why he says it's fine, it's a pyramidal structure. And who is the person who gets? Out of thousands and thousands and thousands of people, there can be one person who can reach the highest, he says. Okay? Having understood that all people are welcome, Krishna says, okay, find out what are all your strengths. Daivi Sampat, he calls it. Tejat Shama Dhruti Shaucham.
Tejat Shama Dhruti Shaucham.
Adroho Nati Manita.
Adroho Nati Manita.
Bhavanti Sampadam Daivim.
Bhavanti Sampadam Daivim.
Abhijatasya Bharata.
Abhijatasya Bharata.
So these are the strengths, the positive virtues. Daivi Sampat, the divine virtues that all of us possess. Arjuna, you are also born with all these good qualities. Don't worry. What are those things? Tejaha, Shama, Dhruti, Shaucha. Then Adrohaha. Then Atimanita, na Atimanita. That full of effulgence, tejas. A person who is full of strength, always full of energy, vitality, dynamism, energy. Full of effulgence, bright. He is not a buddhu. Kshama. He is prepared to forgive others. Normally what we do, we forgive ourselves, not forgive others for the mistake. He is able to forgive others and forget about others. Dhruti, steadfastness. Once he takes up the work, he will continue to do that until he reaches the goal. Arise, awake, stop not till the goal is reached, as Swami Vivekananda said. He has got the dhruti, steadfastness. Shaucha, purity, transparency, integrity, honesty. Full of that shaucha. Adrohaha, no cheating, no stealing. Na atimanita, no arrogance, no ego. These are all our virtues, you please understand, he says. And these are the positive virtues, they are called as the daivi sampatti, is our strength, that we say. What are our weaknesses? Dambho dakko bhimanascha.
Dambho dakko bhimanascha.
Krodha parushya vevacha.
Krodha parushya vevacha.
Ajnanancha bhijatasya.
Ajnanancha bhijatasya.
Artha sampadamasurim.
Artha sampadamasurim.
Are called the Asuri Sampat. That means the demonic vices, Rakshasi good. Those are the weaknesses. Because they are the ones that are called the Shatru, or the enemies. Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya, anger, greed, jealousy, hatred, infatuation, arrogance. No? And here he says how the ego comes up. Dambha, Dappa, Ankara, Abhimana, three types of Ankara, then Krodha, anger, Parushya, and the Ajnana. Everything is born of the Ajnana. These people do not know, that's why they are doing like these things. That is the problem. Therefore, these are the weaknesses that we have. And what are the ways in which Ankara comes? Dambha, Dappa and Abhimana. A person who doesn't have anything, just he goes on blabbering himself. Goes on talking about himself, I have met this person, I have done this, he has done nothing, but he goes on blabbering. Such a person, he is the lowest form. He is called the Abhimana. He is drawn by the conceit, self-conceit, ego. Then the second type of person, he has got education, he has got wealth, and he has got public awards, but he is very arrogant. He looks at everybody as a small grass, fit for nothing. Natrunapapichalati. Without me, nobody should do anything. And even a grass should not move. That is his arrogance. It is called the darpa. Special words in Sanskrit, for each type of ego. And the third is called the ostentation. Arrogance, ostentation. What is this ostentation? He is a philanthropist. He is a good person. He earns a lot of money. He has got a lot of money, health, wealth, everything. And he wants to share with others. He gives. He is a philanthropist. Makes good donations for the works. But always he tags on with a name in that. Okay, I am going to give you so much of donation to this building. How much you want? 1 crore of rupees I will give you. Can you name this building in my father's name, my mother's name, my name? Can you put up a board? Birlas. What they had done? A lot of temples. Birla Mandir. What is inside the temple? We don't know. Birla Mandir. This is called the ego in its own manifestation called Dambha. Why he is describing all these things? Ego is a very subtle thing. Ahankara. It will manifest in various forms. All these things you have to be very good, he says. So therefore understand the weakness and strength, by which what we have to do? Increase the strength and decrease our weakness. That is the whole journey of Bhakti Yoga. So we have to find out what are all the good qualities, what are the negative things, and then we have to see that our positive virtues start developing. Strength will increase and build up your entire house of the strength, and the weakness has to be removed. That is the whole essence of Bhakti Yoga. Let's contemplate, sit straight with the eyes closed. Relax all parts of the body from toes to head. Beautiful smile in the face. Take a deep breath and slowly breathe out. Let us scan our lives. Find out how many good qualities, how many bad qualities we have. Can we start reducing our bad qualities? happiness, anger, jealousy, hatred. You can choose your own and see that is reduced. Consciously and the positive qualities we have to develop. Giving, sharing, dana, the key essence of all daivi sampad. On giving and giving. As I mentioned to you, three acts of good service, of giving, should be made part of our lives. Write a diary in the night. That will completely ennoble you, change you, and move you towards the highest goal of human excellence. That's where Bhakti Yoga starts. The pilgrimage starts. Let us resolve and start working on that day by day. Namaskar Mudra.
Om Asato.